Talk about possibly Pearl 6, possibly Rokulo, possibly Six Lang, which is the latest name, because apparently there's now, again, a conversation going on about what to call it. There you go. So I thought I'd start with a quick introduction. Hi, I'm Simon. I know some of you, I've worked with some of you. I don't know a lot of you because I'm terrible at going to Perl Congress meetings. I've been a Perl developer for 17 years now. This is the second Perlmongers meeting I've ever been to. I've never been to the APSI. I've not got anything to count on. But there you go. I love Perls. I love Perl. I love Perl 5. Maybe I like Perl 6 as well. No, I mean, but Perl's the language that got me to want to program computers again. Why am I talking about Perl 6? Because it has been in development for pretty much my entire life as a Perl developer. You know, I came into a place and they were on 5.8 at the time, and Perl 6 was just being announced. It's like, it's a big thing, it's great. And yeah, so I have basically, you know, it was like, and then it disappeared, and occasionally I would see stuff about Perl 6. You know, so yeah, I know all the jokes, I know it's not a thing. But I think that it's really worth you taking a bit of time. Have a look at Perl 6, have a look at where it is now, because it is at a point where if you don't want to put it in production now, you may want to put it in production in a few months. You might want to start really seriously thinking about it. I'm going to explain a few things about it that I think really make it worthwhile looking at. So here's my first slide. Now, I've realised since I wrote this slide deck that this is a terrible slide because it really shouldn't have all this stuff in it. But what we have here is Perl 6 has got the best Unicode support in any language. Because not only can you use Unicode characters in things, but you can also define. So we've got the first line here defines a variable as Latin small letter A with a cute. Second variable is defined as X301, which is Latin small A with a cute. The third one, and then they're the same thing. But somewhere in the brand here. That X301 isn't a cute. So that's defining our second one as A followed by the cute, which it composes down into A the cute. And it says they're the same thing. And when you uppercase them, it gives you the same thing. And then down there I'm just doing some crazy stuff by doing using like random characters. Times by 3/4 squared and getting 2.25 because it does rational numbers properly, does floating point variables properly as well. But best Unicode support, and it's getting better. You know, so if you need to deal with any language that uses anything outside of the ASCII range, you want to have a look at Perl 6. High level concurrent asynchronous methods. It's got some lovely stuff for doing asynchronous work and for doing threads. So you've got promises to let you, which work similar to like promises in JavaScript and all the other things. Supplies, where you can basically generate supply, attach event listeners onto it, and then just fire events at it. And I was actually writing some stuff the other week, mainly as a test to see if it would work, and I came across some issues, which I'll get to in a second. But where I had multiple threads doing web requests to an API, and then as they got the results in, they were firing off to a supply, and the supply reader was just writing that all out to a CSV file. And that all part of it all worked wonderfully. It was really easy to write. So yeah, channels is the next bit, which is basically data queues, really simple to use. You can just create a channel, you write stuff into it, and then you can read other stuff into the channel. And there's some of the things you've got on supplies are timers, so you can have heartbeats going on, and you can have your event handlers pulling all this kind of stuff in. So if you want any kind of event-driven code, it's really lovely. Proc Async is a module that basically allows you to do asynchronous calls to external processes. So if you want to fire up external process is going to take a little bit of time and you want to just keep an eye on it, you've got that just built in. So Perl 6 moves over to threads rather than forking. So don't do forking in Perl 6. Use the forking. Just don't. You want to be going with asynchronous. Proc Async is your one. Last few bits, slightly unrelated. junk chambers. If anybody's seen any of Damien Conway's talks on this, he's freaking insane. They really are. I just love them. It's just the craziness of this whole bit where you can like define variables, and it's like, oh, yeah, go and watch his talks on junk junctions if you've not watched them, because they are just like, whoa, and they're all in there. And then you've got where you can do, if you want to do like a map or something on a list, because I think some of us may, at some point in the time in our Perl coding career, have done a map on a list. So Perl 6, you can just say, I would like that to be done threaded, please. Just, you know, fire it off, divvy it up into chunks, thread it, and call it through. Parallel. Hyper and race. One of them is ordered, one's not ordered, depending on if it's important. These are lovely. Plus, there is a whole like low-level thread locking system as well if you really want to play around with the threads, but you don't have to. This stuff is lovely. Like I say, I'm not going to go too far into a lot of the detail. There is a couple of slides here. There's some crazy. Another thing, yeah. So if you like Moose, you will like the Perl 6 object system, because it's basically Moose, but you don't have to do a massive CPAN like build before you build your project, because it's all built into the language. It's all there, roles of meta objects, the whole thing. Signatures, you know, 526 signatures are basically in Perl 6, straight up. The crazy bit being, yeah, you can, functions are objects, yeah, signatures are objects. I still haven't quite managed to jam a signature onto an object, like onto a function. Like, I'm sure there's a way of doing it, but without, like, just, well, like, dynamically, I was playing around with that at some point when I wrote this thing. The typing system, you can type stuff, you don't have to type stuff. If you don't care about types, then don't type stuff. If you do care about types, you can, and it will allow you to do bits of that. You can type in the signatures. You've got multi-methods, which let you basically define multiple different versions of a method with different signatures, and it will pick the correct one for things. And as all the operators are methods and are defined as multis, you can just override any operator. I'll show you that in a later slide. By just defining it with a different signature. The other thing is the subtypes, which are, again, I've got another slide on. Subtypes are great because they basically allow you to say, define a type as a subset of a larger type. So you can say, I want a string, but it's got to be at least 10 characters long. And that's a type. And it's like defined in one line. And yeah, it is, you don't need to use signatures. Well, no, you don't really, you can. I think you can actually pull arguments. So signatures you kind of need to, but the typing system especially, you just don't have to do it. You can just say, alright, don't need to, whatever, and I'll deal with it. You know, and sometimes that's what you want. But if you do add it in, it will make stuff a bit faster. The VM's got some stuff in it where it will start doing speeding things up. You know, if it spots that you're using the same call with the same types every time, so it can speed stuff up. It runs on its own VM, the more VM, but the JVM, they're doing a lot of work at the moment to get it running again on the JVM. It's been a bit iffy on the JVM, but they're aiming to get it back up and running properly on the JVM really soon. So if you have to put stuff on the JVM, there we go. Hey, you had written that somewhere. Other stuff. So yeah, runs on the JVM. Set theory. It's got the. I love. That's another one of these things about it. I love it, is that you can you can define sets, and you've got a whole set of set theory operators. So you can say like, define a set of things and have another set of things and do these things, have a union, is one a subset of the other. It's got a whole set of set theory operators as both Unicode operators, so like the standard mathematical Unicode operators, and you've got the larger ones if you need to type them in ASCII. A lot of the operators, they've got Unicode ones. Lazy lists, you can just define lazy lists, it's so simple, it really is, and iterables and iterators and sequences, things are all really simple. No problem. Grammars, that's one of those things you can do a whole talk on, is the grammar system. I mean, I won't, because I still don't fully understand it, but it's amazing. It's, you know, because it takes regular expressions and blows them up. The one thing I would say, You're going to have to learn regular expressions again. The total change of regular expressions in that. Sorry about that. but it's more powerful. I should really have a separate slide for this next line. Native call. I've now used native call a bit more, and native call is amazing. Right? That's cool, because I'm not going to have it. Native call basically lets you call external libraries using straight up Perl. You don't have to write any like intermittent XS stuff. You just can define your library. I was playing around with SPL the other day and getting it running on with Perl 6 and native call. Really simple. You just need, if you've got the headers, you can simply define them. A couple of things. Inline Perl is really new Perl code in Perl 6, but it's not very easy to do. Yeah, rational numbers by default, so 0.1 plus 0.2 minus 0.3 does equal 0. Which, yeah, but you try that in most languages, then it won't. And finally, I've got a couple of crazy slides. So this crazy slide is subsets. I'm defining a UK postcode. It's a string where the string star matches this regular expression, which is our great postcode expression. So that's the one that we used to be on the Royal Mail website. I defined it to a multi-thing called checkpc, check postcode. One of them accepts UK postcode and returns true. The other one accepts anything and returns false. So when I call it with a valid postcode, it returns true, because hey, it's matched that one. But when I call it with a Bob's House, which isn't a valid postcode, it returns false, because it hasn't matched the type there that I've defined as a subset. Now, all right, technically that's one line, okay? So as I said, you can define them in one line. Technically that is one line. And my final crazy example, and this is someone the other day posted on a thing about how you would model standard like SI units. So here we have, I'm defining a role of a unit with a size and descriptor. A distance has a descriptor of n. And then here I'm defining the postfix m operator. So I can say h, my height is 10m, and that's created a distance. And then here I'm creating an area, and that's defined with m squared. And then I can define the m squared postfix operator, if I call that, that will create me an area. I can say 100 m squared, and that will create me an area. Boom, and it's a defined thing. And then over here, I've defined the postfix squared operator, which lets me take my h and do h squared, and that will give me the area for h squared. And then finally, I'm doing infix multiplier to multiply two distance, to get an area, and that's what I'm doing down here. And then when I say a, I get 200 meters squared, because I define that as my thing. Now, I'm still working on this a little bit, because I've been trying to get it so that does numeric, and then you can do like straight up equals, and you can just go, does this equal this, and it won't. But it's getting there. I'd hate to think how much time that would take to write it. How useful it is to any of us here, I don't know. But for being able to define, you know, just the power that is in the object system, the power that's in the language, and like I said, the only issue I've really had with it is that libssl, which it uses for making, which a lot of the different stuff uses for making SSL calls, doesn't handle threads. So when you're trying to do this, is the thing I was doing with the REST calls, was it was doing it over HTTPS and it kept crashing because the threads were getting bumped about. But that's the only real issue I've had with it. Plus it's not as fast as Perl 5 for all the things. There you go. That's pretty much what I was going to say. Questions? Here we go.
why have I put M2 rather than M squared?
Where did I put M2?
Bottom right.
No, where did I put
bottom 2? Right.
Bottom right.
Because I literally wrote that about 2 hours ago and missed it off. Like, that's why everything else is a square. I literally just threw that line in at the bottom.
Correction, when you give a talk at LPW.
Yes, I will, yes. So do you think I should? Yeah. Okay. Cool. So there we go. Any other questions? Hello.
So that's the language. What are applications in it? What's CPAN 6 look like these days?
Well, CPAN, so there's a bunch of modules already in it, and CPAN 6 is CPAN. You can put Perl 6 modules into CPAN, and the module installer will look in CPAN for them. There's one thing I think everybody should keep an eye on, which is CRO, which is being CRO, which was announced, I think, at the Swiss Perl conference or something recently, that Jonathan Worthington's working on, which is designed for asynchronous microservices. It's basically for building microservices that talk to each other. And it looks really nice and well worth a look. But yeah, there are some, it doesn't have everything that the Perl 5 basically, you know, it doesn't have Moot, but it doesn't need Moot. It's got a DVI thing, it's got DVI-ish, yeah, but it doesn't have like DVI-C yet. You know, there are some modules in there that I wish were a bit nicer, and I think some of the guys really need to work on documenting them. You know, when you go to like a module and there is no documentation on how to use it.
I've
got that. Yeah, it's like, yeah, okay, yeah. But yes, it doesn't have the set how many umpty years of CPAN libraries in there, but there is stuff out there and there is people working on it. And it's not that hard to know. Cool.
You suggested that if we haven't already installed it in production, we might want to in the next few months.
Seriously?
On what ground?
On what ground?
You expect
okay, so like I say, one thing I would say is that if you do have to deal with Unicode in any like level, then it's well worth looking at as instead of, because I mean even Perl 5 sometimes it doesn't do things properly. For instance, the different ways of handling the cutes and all that kind of stuff, the composed values and stuff. So that's a good one to look at. The threading model is really good, really worth looking at. If you're having to deal with external, I had to deal with at the moment. Sorry, I think my time is out. I've had to deal with AppDynamics recently, and that involved a CSDK, and then there was an XS wrapper that involved talking to it and all this kind of stuff. Whereas native call, if you're having to deal with like external libraries, native call makes it so much easier. Those are two things that I think are really worth it. You're having those things in the way are worth looking at. Plus, like I say, it's a lot. It makes some things that you can do in Perl 5 but a pain a little bit easier to do. And I just like it.
And
so
I have more questions for Simon.
You can ask me later.